Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Labor unions have been excluded from every major trade agreement, and the lack of strong labor protection is becoming more and more apparent. I have attorneys Howard Nations and Mike Burg with me now to talk about how labor unions could have prevented worker deaths and other atrocities all over this globe. Howard, labor enforcement really does matter. We see it time and time again with places like Bangladesh or China, or Saipan. Tell us the Bangladesh story, and then let's explain how we are being made into a Bangladesh right here in the United States.
Mike, the Bangladesh story is just outrageous. On April 24th of this year, in Rana Plaza Garment Factory, there was a collapse of the 8-story building. The interesting part of that, and the outrageous part of that, is the day before, the inspectors had been in and the police had ordered the building to be closed because cracks were showing in the building. The garment workers came back to work because they were ordered to do so. They were there. 1,129 were killed when the building collapsed the following day, and 1,500 were injured. These were mostly young women who were being paid $37 per month. It's the worst disaster in the history of global garment industry. It's a reminder, Mike, of what happened in the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire in March of 1911 in New York City. There were 146 deaths and 71 injuries there. As a result of that, all sorts of legislation came out, and it's never happened again in the last 102 years in this country. But the refusal to take any action to stop it. In Bangladesh, this is the third such incident in the last year. And this Rana Plaza is making garments for more than one dozen fashion brands, including Benetton, JCPenney, and Walmart.
Yeah, Michael, let me go to you on this. You remember you and I did a story a few years ago, I think it was a radio story, where we talked about Tom DeLay going to Saipan. He gets to Saipan, he sees that people are working for $1 a day. He sees they're working 18 hours a day. He sees they have no leave time. He sees they have no health care. Tom DeLay, senator from Texas, along with a whole handful of other Republican senators, they come back to the United States and they say, this is the model that works, and this is the model we want in the United States. Do you remember that playing itself out right here on our cameras in the United States?
I do, Mike. And you know what's so horrible about it is they have actually put the plan in place. They're getting rid of the labor unions who, quite frankly, protect our workers by making sure that they're safe. They make sure the hours are done right. They make sure there's no child labor, making sure they're enforcing that. They've also dismantled OSHA. The plan is to have Saipan or Bangladesh here in the United States, and having workers working for pennies, making sure that they're working long hours and there's no protection. They want to impose that here, and we're going to have tragedies like this again in the United States if Congress and the people of the United States don't do something about
it. Well, you know, Michael, we see people hear stories like this and they say, well, that's Bangladesh, that's China. The stories that Howard was just telling us, those are in other places. And we don't seem to grasp that the people who have been outsourcing all these years have figured out, why don't we just do that here? And so it begins obviously with undermining the public unions and then taking away the teeth from the national unions. Howard, how do we enforce, how does the United States ever get to the point to where we enforce any type of global labor rights when we almost just ignore the Wagner Act here in the United States? It's almost as if we have lost sight of how the American Union built America's middle class. We don't put much value in that. How do we ever enforce internationally?
Well, you're absolutely right. For example, after the Bangladesh incident, our international enforcement was to reward Bangladesh and make them the second largest garment manufacturing country in the world. 160 million people, 4 million of them are in the garment business, and they have 40 building inspectors over there. They have no rights, virtual slave labor. Now, in order to try to do something about it, there is a movement for corporate accountability. There are four different aspects of it. After the Rana Plaza collapse, there was a great outcry. So there, the things that will bring about change are the global labor movement. The domestic labor movement is in trouble, big trouble, because it's under attack by the Republican Party. But there's a global labor movement. There's anti-sweatshop activists, and there is a labor-affiliated advocacy group called Workers' Rights Consortium. Now, they passed in earlier this year, they passed an accord on building and fire safety in Bangladesh. And in that accord, it's a legal contract. The big retailers and the producers are responsible for factory safety, and they've agreed to invest millions of dollars in safety and to give long-term contracts to the owners of the garment factories. It's backed up by independent safety inspections, and those safety inspections are made public. There's binding arbitrations, and they terminate business of a factory if it's found to be unsafe.
Yeah, Michael, let me go to you on this. The truth is, you can have all the voluntary you want, but unless you have a government-to-government dialogue, a narrative government-to-government, and the government says, listen, we're giving you some favored nations tariffs. We're telling you, Bangladesh, as Howard was just talking about, we're telling you that we're going to put you on a list of favored nations that we're going to deal with. We're going to have corporations basically outsourcing, taking American jobs away from America and sending them to Bangladesh, and we're also going to give you tariff breaks in the process. Now, without organized labor there to control wages, to control hours, to control safety, to control wages, where does that really go?
Really doesn't go anywhere. We have the Fair Labor Association. They're trying to do it on a voluntary basis. It's not working. And it's not only Republicans. Clinton, with NAFTA, over the objections of the Democrats, they got NAFTA through, and this is where it all began. It began in the Clinton administration, in which they were trying to figure out how we're going to have lower costs for our products. And by going overseas and creating these sweatshops, we do have lower costs at the Walmarts, at the JCPenney's. But at what cost? The cost of lives.
Michael, right on your topic there, you see, we came away from the Clinton years thinking, oh, what a hero this man is for the working man. And we missed the whole, a lot of people missed this. The media intentionally missed it. You had mainstream media intentionally miss the fact that what Clinton knew, he was being told directly, if you do this, if you open these trade agreements on NAFTA and CAFTA without any type of labor responsibility on the other end, the United States can never compete with this outsourcing, and we're going to have exactly these things that labor was telling us was going to happen in places like Bangladesh and China, India, all parts of the world where you have these huge clothing manufacturers that really don't give a damn. You know, they have their PR machine saying, oh yeah, we really care about how workers are treated. The history doesn't show that, does it, Michael?
Does not. In fact, in 2012, there was a fire in a garment factory in Pakistan. 300 people were killed. Again, no one even talked about it. And the problem we have is people say we want to compete with the world labor market. And here in the United States, we're starting to see again these kinds of problems because the unions are not there. The people are not unionized. And OSHA has been basically stripped of any power. And right now we have problems here in the United States exactly the same. And we're going to have tragedies like occurred in Bangladesh right here.
Howard, let me go to you on this. Again, somebody watching this broadcast may say, you know what, this doesn't really affect me because it's over in, over in Pakistan, it's over, Bangladesh. I mean, it's only these bleeding heart liberals that care that, that 1,500 women burned to death because there's no labor standards there. It doesn't really affect me, and I get to buy my shoes for less money. I get to buy my T-shirts for less money. But what they miss, Howard, and I'd like you to talk about this just a little bit, don't they miss the fact that in NAFTA and CAFTA, by definition, they defined health safety and welfare and labor issues as obstacles to free trade. And now we see that same language coming over here across the ocean to the United States, where we're seeing that same language as health, safety, and welfare of the workers is simply an obstacle. Aren't we seeing that more and more in the United States?
You're seeing that here, and the lessons from Bangladesh and China are the lessons that we should be applying to Wisconsin. Because as the labor movement in these United States is under direct assault, and it's under assault and not getting the support from the Democrats, under assault from the Republicans, it's in real jeopardy. And what is happening in Bangladesh can happen here if you do not have politicians who are willing to back labor, politicians who are willing to take substantial risk of their own in backing labor unions and in shoring up labor unions. We have to have the labor unions, and the assault on labor unions in this country is going to have absolutely devastating effects in our factories and across the board, even in our schools with our teachers. It's absolutely outrageous what's happening to the labor unions in this country. And it's going to take brave politicians, and it's going to take a movement from the American public to back labor.
Right. Michael, let me go to you really quickly in about a minute. I remember a few years ago you talking to me about how pleased you were about the college movement in the United States actually doing more than our government where it comes to enforcing labor laws. Tell us really quickly what they did with the Worker Right Consortium, where they said you can't come on our campus unless you comply.
Absolutely. It's been an amazing, and we need that kind of groundswell, which is basically we're not going to allow those products into the university. You can't come on campus. You can't interview unless you enforce safety laws and make sure that people are getting fair wages. We need that kind of groundswell from the American people. If we don't get it, labor unions are in trouble, and we're going to have our grandchildren working for pennies on the dollar and in unsafe work conditions.
Yeah, and the situation I remember you recalled that you talked about one time was Russell, you know, thought that they could elbow their way through and ignore labor law, and college campuses said, well, you can do that if you want, but you will not sell your damn products on our campus, and Russell backed down. Guys, this is another important story. Y'all covered it very well. Thank you for joining me. We'll continue talking about it because this year it'll become more and more important.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.